Hey, Sammy D in my mobile, just sharing the word of the Lord to bless you, to strengthen you in the things of God. I always like to start off by saying that Jesus is Lord, because we have a lot of different views today, philosophies, religion, concepts, theology, philosophy, psychology, and trick analogy. But Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, if you've had a born-again experience and encounter with God, you know this to be a fact, that Jesus, there's something about that name, is the Lord. And I want to come to you today from the Gospel, chapter 2 of St. John's, verse 19. John chapter 2, verse 19. Jesus said, if you destroy this temple, I'll raise it up, build it up again in 3 days. Now, of course, the Pharisees were talking about the physical temple that took years to be built. But Jesus was talking about his life, his temple. He said, I'll raise it up in 3 days. Now, if somebody can make that statement and somebody can back that up, to me, he's super bad. You know, James Brown made a song some years ago and it was a hit. The Father and Godfather of Soul. He said, I'm super bad. But he got that from Jesus' personality and ministry. Jesus is not only a superstar, but he's super bad. And I want to entitle this message, Jesus Christ is super bad. And I get that from 3 different reasons. One, because if the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, in the same chapter of John, chapter 1, it says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, meaning that God is Jesus, and Jesus is God. There's some people that have a problem with that. According to the word of God, Jesus and God are one, and Jesus created everything by the word of his power, and he created it for himself and by himself, therefore making him to be super bad. If you know anyone that can create things by speaking it, a word of faith, a word is the expression of an invisible thought. He thought it and then he spoke it. Let there be light, and the light appeared, came out of him, because he is the light of the world. He put the stars in his place. He named them. He put the galaxy, the sun, the moon. He stretched out the heavens like a curtain. He holds the water in the palm of his hand. Every river, every ocean, every sea, every lake, every swimming pool, the fire hydrant, the forces, every drop of water, he holds it in the palm of his hand. The earth is his footstool. The clouds are the dust of his feet. He has thunder and lightning when he speaks. He has the power to create things. He formed man from the dust of the earth, and then he breathed into him, and man became a living soul. And then he puts him to sleep, and he takes out a rib, and in my humble opinion, he made the woman the most beautiful of his creation. Guys, can you say amen? Women also. So God has the power to create everything by his word. He is super bad. And not only in creation, but then also in working with man. For instance, Moses, God appeared to him by way of a burning bush. It was a miracle. Why? Because the bush was not consumed. I don't care what problem you're going through, what problem you're facing, what storm, what stronghold, what kind of devil, demons comes against you, and I'm not underestimating, I'm not belittling, I'm not overlooking your circumstances, but I do know one thing, that God is able to bring you through, bring you out. If he can bring you to it, he'll bring you through it. Why? Because he's super bad. And when he appeared to Moses, he said, Moses, take your shoes off. The place you're standing on is holy ground. And I got a message for you. Go down to Egypt and tell old Pharaoh, and I said, let my people go. And Moses said, well, who should I say sent me? Tell them that I am that I am. In other words, I'm super bad. Not that I was, not that I will be, but I am today. Whatever you need him to be, he's right there presently to be that what you need. So he shows up to Moses, and then he shows up to Nehemiah the prophet. Y'all know the story. When the walls came down, Nehemiah was very broken. He was hurt. And Nehemiah was the king's cupbearer. You know what that entails, right? Every time the king got some food or something to drink come up from the kitchen, Nehemiah have to taste it first. And if somebody was plotting to kill the king, Nehemiah would take that poison, take a bullet for him. But God had his hand upon Nehemiah, and nothing hurt him. He didn't allow no poison to come against him, because the hand of the Lord was upon him. And God's hand is upon you. God has given you grace. Nothing God allows comes your way. Nothing will hurt you. Nothing will harm you unless God allows it, and God is protecting you. Now, if Nehemiah would have dropped dead because of the poison, you know the king was going to kill the whole kitchen crew. From the cook, the chef, the waiters, the waitress, whoever sweeps, whoever puts up the tables, the host, everybody whip had to go because they were trying to kill the king. But God protected Nehemiah. So one day the king asked Nehemiah, what's wrong? You look so sad. He said, because the walls of Jerusalem has come down. Now the walls signify the protection of God, the correction of God, the direction of God. They had walls to protect them from their enemies, security. And he said, I need security. And the king said, go ahead, take whatever you need and build those walls, rebuild them. And Nehemiah went to work. It is important to have those walls up to secure you. What walls, Sammy? The walls of the word of God, the walls of Jesus Christ protecting you, the walls of praise and prayer and worship and prayer. Build walls around you so when the enemy comes in, he can't get to you, because you have the shield of faith to shoot down any dots of the enemy. Come on, shout praise the Lord, somebody. Now they came to Nehemiah. You know the enemy always comes, and he told him, step down, man, stop working like that. And Nehemiah sends message back to them and says, tell them that I'm doing a good work and I cannot come down. Why should the work stop? And I'm sure there's been time when they told you, stop doing the work of God, stop going to church, stop praying, stop reading your Bible, stop walking right with God. Circumstances has told you that, people's told you that, perhaps people in the church, perhaps problems, sickness, disease, all kinds of issues that come against you to stop you. But you got to say like Nehemiah, I'm doing a great work and I cannot come down. Why? Because the Lord that I serve, it's super bad. Yes, sir. And then there was Daniel. You know the story of Daniel when they threw him in the lion's den, and they were ferocious lion. They were hungry. They were starving, and they threw them in there. And Daniel said, I'm not going to bow down to your false image. I'm not going to serve you or your God. I serve the mighty true God, the living God. And I'm not bowing my knees before no image. And the king said, well, I'm going to have to throw you in the lion's den. And he said, go ahead. And when they threw him in there, there was another lion that showed up. I'm sure the three lions that were in there, or maybe more, they said to each other, weren't just three of us? And they said, yeah, I see four of them, and one of them is the line of the tribe of Judah. Jesus is known as the line of the tribe of Judah. And when he got in there, he took care of the other lions. Daniel was not touched. He was not harmed, because there's always a lion of the tribe of Judah to protect you and to keep you. Why? Because Jesus Christ is super bad. And then there were the three Hebrew boys. I'm going to pronounce it the way I know it. My shack, your shack, and a billy goat. You know it ain't pronounced like that. You can look it up for yourself. They threw them in the fire. And they raised up the fire. And then there was a fireman that came in and put out the fire. And the king said to the other servant, didn't we just throw three of them in there? I said, yeah, we threw the three Hebrew boys. Well, I see four of them, and one of them is like the Son of Man. Jesus stepped in there and he put out the fire. Why? Because he's super bad. And then we have King David when he was young, before he was the king. You know, he stayed in the backside of the desert, and there one day a lion came and took one of their sheep. He just got up and chased the lion and opened up his mouth and took the sheep back. And then the lion didn't tell the bear what David did to him. He then came over the bear and he took one of the sheep. This is in the Bible. This is not Walt Disney. This is not a fairy tale from Wonderland. This is not a comic book. This is an actual event. You got to read your Bible to find out. Read 1st, 2nd Samuel. It's right there in the Bible. And when the bear came, David did the same thing to the bear. Opened up his mouth and took back the sheep. So he had already practiced boxing and fighting. Why? Because Jesus is super bad. And then David went before Goliath the giant, and all of Israel was shaking. They were afraid because of the giant. Hallelujah. And David went to Saul, the king at the time. He said, let me take care of this for you, king. He says, man, you're too young. You can't handle this. Well, he said, I had an experience in the back. There was a bear and there was a lion, and I tore them up, and I've experienced in warfare. Let me get in there. I'm going to make this giant food for dogs. This uncircumcised Philistine cannot defile the armies of God. And when he went in there, he took a stone from the brook and a slingshot, and he shot it up. And when he shot it up, it hit the giant right in the forehead and killed him. Then he chopped his head off, and he went around showing the giant's head. I killed him. That's one way to get ahead in life. Why? Because Jesus is super bad. Come on, shout praise the Lord, somebody. He had won many victories. He won the victory of Joshua when they marched around the wall 7 times and the walls came down. He won the victory for King Jehoshaphat when the enemies came at him and there were more in God's side than those that were against him. He won the battle for Elijah the prophet. He won the battle for Jeremiah when they came against him. He has a history of winning many battles. Let me make you a challenge. I'm going to challenge you, my friend. If you can find in the Bible, listen to me, if you can find in the Bible anywhere that God lost a battle, I'll give you $100. What'd you say? Make it 500? Okay, I'll give you $500 cash. I'll either deliver it to you, I'll mail it to you. If you can go in the Bible and read from cover to cover and look in your concordance and talk to your bishop and your professor and tell me that God lost the battle, that they took him off the throne, that he cannot win this battle, then I'll give you $500 cash, not monopoly money and not food stamps, cash money in your hand. But if you cannot find anywhere where God lost the battle, if you cannot find anywhere when they overcame and they overtook God and he had to step down from the throne, then I'm going to tell you, my friend, keep quiet. I like to tell you, like in the hood, like they say in my neighborhood, or like they say in the ghetto, shut your face. But I won't tell you that because I respect you. But I'll just tell you, keep quiet, because God has never lost a battle. Why? Because he's super bad. And we have Jesus healing many. He healed the blind man Barnabas. Barnabas was blind as a bat. He couldn't see. And one day he heard that Jesus was coming out of Jericho. Jericho was a busy city like New York City. And this man used to beg all the time. And he heard of Jesus. He couldn't see, but he can hear. And he said, what's that? What's that noise I hear? It's different. And there were some people there. And I'm sure they testified. Maybe it was Lazarus. You remember when he called Lazarus from the dead? Mary Lazarus told the blind man, well, Lazarus, I'm Lazarus. He woke me up from the dead. I was dead already 3 days and I stunk. But he called me out, Lazarus, and I rose from the dead. And he did that for me. Maybe it was the woman with the issue of blood. You remember her? She suffered. She was subject and she spent everything trying to find healing. But one day she heard Jesus was passing by and she went up to him and she pulled and she pulled and she pulled the hem of his garment. And when she pulled, power came out of him and she was healed immediately. Maybe it was some of the leprechauns, some of the people that Jesus healed. They testify to this blind man by the name of blind Bartimaeus. He was a beggar. And blind Bartimaeus said, Jesus! And they told him to shut up. Maybe you've been crying out to Jesus and things and circumstances. And people have been telling you to shut up. Maybe somebody at your church that don't like you. They bamboozle them, they lampoon, and they talk all about you, and you shut up. You kept quiet in a little corner somewhere like Pee Wee Herman. And I'm here to tell you, shake that off and get back in there. And the blind man said, Jesus, Son of David! He recognized who he was. He recognized that he was the Son of David, deity, that he was Jesus, the Christ, the Savior, the Messiah. And Jesus said, who's that calling me? And they said, ain't nobody but a poor old beggar, blind. He said, bring him over here. And when they went to him, they said, cheer up. The master is calling you. Anytime God calls you, I don't know where you're at. Maybe you're shooting some dope. Maybe you're smoking some coke. Maybe you're drinking some booze. Maybe you're popping some pills. Maybe you're in and out of all kinds of relationships that are useless. Maybe you are enjoying pleasures and you're blind. But God is calling you and he's telling you, come to me. Cheer up. The master is calling you. Why? Because he's super bad. Come on. Shout praise. Praise the Lord, somebody. Excuse me. And finally, I'm going to finish it by the fact that if you're drowning in waters like Peter was, your Savior is a lifeguard. He walks on the waters and he'll pull you up. He'll pull you out. He'll pull you in to himself. And then we have the event of the resurrection. They crucified him. They nailed him to a tree. And then they buried him. And after one day, everybody was saying, that's it. It's over. They buried the Messiah. Hallelujah. The second day, I'm sure the devil was down in hell playing dominoes or playing cards with his posse. And then the third day came about. And then there was an earthquake. The earth shook, and the Bible said that the sky turned black, and then the rocks were ripped in half, and the veil of the temple that kept people from going into the presence of God, and that was a thick veil, it was ripped in half. Now we can go into the presence of God. You don't have to go through a priest. You don't have to go through a man. You don't have to go through an agency or a denomination. You can come straight to God, no matter what you look like. You can smell like wine. You can smell like a pig. You can be lost, but you can enter into the presence of God. You can come right into his presence because Jesus ripped the veil in half. And on the third day, he got up. He went right to the devil and he knocks the door and he says, give me the keys of life and death. And he took back the keys. Why? Because he's super bad. And that's when he said, if you kill this body, if you destroy it, I'll bring it back up in 3 days. And on the third day, he resurrected. He's alive. He's not dead. Thousands upon thousands and millions upon millions have met the Savior, has had an encounter. I've met the Savior. I know he's alive. I know he lives in me. And then he ascended to heaven and he sends down the Holy Spirit to live in us. And he reveals Jesus. He reveals the cross. He reveals our victory. He reveals our joy. He reveals our peace. He reveals Jesus to be the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, the bright in the morning star, Jehovah Jireh, our provider, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Shalom, our peacemaker, Jehovah that is always with us. He reveals this to us. And I'm here to tell you, my friend, Jesus is super bad. If you want to hang out with anybody, you can hang out with your buddies, drink and play dominoes and go out and have fun. But you can't hang out with anybody that's meaner, that's tougher, that's greater, that's better than Jesus, super bad. Come on, shout praise God, somebody. Woo! My friend, whatever you're going through, whatever you're facing, whatever your difficulties, whatever your struggles in life, you might be sad. You might be sitting there like a bump in a log. like you lost your best friend. You might be having problems at home, problems with your children, problem with your money, problem with your bank account, problem with your credit cards, problem with your health, problem with everything else in your life. I'm here to tell you, for a witness to Jesus, that he indeed is super bad. There ain't nobody worse. There ain't nobody better. There ain't nobody that can do you good than Jesus. And when I say worse, I mean like bad, like in good. There's nobody better than Jesus. He can do you good. He'll love you. He'll take you in. He'll restore you. He'll dry your tears. He'll run, chase away your fears. He'll lift you up. He'll restore you and put you up on high. Why? Because he's super bad. I'm about finished. I think I said enough for you to understand. Jesus is super bad. Father, in Jesus' name, bless whoever's listening right now. Touch their lives. Bring healing and deliverance into their lives. God bless you. And remember, Jesus Christ, he's super bad.